general epistle of the Apostle Peter, chapter 4, and I shall read from verses 7 to 11. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled, so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. In the year 1963, the actor Marlon Brando starred in a film which was called The Ugly American. It was a fictitious story, but it dealt with the foreigner's perception of Americans. Many people in other countries have viewed the American tourists and the business people as arrogant, too demanding, too wasteful, ignorant of the local conditions, and intolerant. Have there actually been an ugly American? Unfortunately, yes, there has been. Those Americans who traveled abroad or lived overseas sometimes acted badly, and their bad behavior has tarnished all of us. The image of the ugly American was perpetuated because Americans tend to think of themselves as being superior to all others, culturally, industrially, and militarily. Americans are cognizant of the fact that they belong to the wealthiest and most powerful nation on earth, and so they've come to view themselves as being the best people on the face of this earth, that they are second to none. They rank first all the time in everything. Now, our scripture reading for today contains a warning. It's a warning against being an ugly Christian. Have you ever known a Christian who was arrogant, demanding, and intolerant? I'm sure all of us have met such people. You have probably heard of a person called Christopher Hitchens. He was a British journalist who wrote a book entitled God Is Not Great. And this book made the bestseller list a few years back. Christopher Hitchens was a militant atheist, and he hated all Christians and used insulting language to describe them. Then he developed throat cancer and died at the age of 62. How appropriate that he lost the throat that he has used to blaspheme God. Some of the online comments made by Christians were quite revealing. Some Christians said that they were praying for Christopher Hitchens' recovery and they were asking God to lead him to faith in Jesus Christ, while others cursed him and used very vulgar language to express their deep hatred for him. There are times when Christians can get pretty ugly. Those who cursed and hated Mr. Hitchens thought they were doing God a favor, but in reality they were not. God did not save us to pass judgment even on the worst sinners. Judging people is God's prerogative, that's his business. Let's not rob God of that prerogative. In today's scripture reading, we read that God wants us to be clear-minded and self-controlled. The word self-controlled means restraint. If a Christian restrains himself, he won't use vulgar language, he won't curse, he won't hate anyone, because we're commanded to love everyone, even our enemies. In today's scripture reading, we're commanded to love one another deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. In today's scripture reading, we're commanded to offer hospitality to one another without grumbling, and to use whatever gifts God has given us to serve him and our fellow men. In other words, the Apostle Peter encouraged us to be nice people, to be pleasant and kind to all people. One survey conducted recently showed that 60% of Americans prayed at least once a day. But the reason they prayed was to have God do things for them. They did not pray to ask God to empower them to serve him and their fellow men. They did not pray to ask God to equip them to be witnesses for him in this world. Twice in this passage that we read today, the Apostle Peter tells us to be clear-minded. That means we should not allow our minds to be distracted by the things of this world. We have to bend our will to God's will so that we will be able to pray as we should. Love one another deeply, we're told. And you may ask why. Why should we love one another deeply? Well, the Apostle Peter said, because love covers a multitude of sins. And because the Apostle Paul says, we have all sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. We all can be hard people to get along with. Someone once remarked that Christians are like porcupines. They huddle together to receive warmth, but they end up injuring one another with their sharp quills. You know, the porcupine has quills that are like sharp needles. So Christians huddle together to gain warmth in fellowship, but because they are like porcupines, they end up hurting, injuring one another with their quills. So we have to be careful at all times. Isn't it ironic that we flatter the stranger whom we scarcely know? We do our utmost to please our guests, but we wound those who are closest to us. Love is not only an emotion. Love, to be genuine, must be expressed in actions. The Apostle Peter tells us that we have to find ways to serve one another. We have to find ways to love one another. We have to find ways to be nice and kind to one another. I want to direct your attention now to a verse in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. It says, let us spur, S-P-U-R, let us spur one another toward love and good deeds. A spur is a device with a small spike that's worn on the heel of a rider to urge a horse to move forward or to run. So to spur one another to love and good deeds means to encourage one another to do those good activities. To spur means to encourage an activity or to make it happen faster. In Luke chapter 12, verses 45-48, Jesus says, suppose a servant says to himself — this is a man who is talking to himself, he's not crazy, but he's talking to himself — and he says, my Lord is delaying his return. So he begins to beat his fellow servants, to drink and get drunk. And then he says, the master of that servant will come one day when he is least expected, and he will assign that wicked servant a place with the unbelievers, meaning he would be in hell. What is Jesus is telling us here? What is Jesus telling us in these verses in Luke chapter 12? He's telling us that if you want to be my servant, you should not abuse people. You should not mistreat people. The church in the Greek city of Corinth had such a problem. They were always at each other's throats. The Corinthian church was the most problematic church that the Apostle Paul had to deal with. They argued about who was important. They argued about the best gifts, what were the best gifts. They argued about legal matters and marital matters and spiritual matters. They argued almost about everything. And this argumentative and uncaring spirit was carried over into their worship. Every week when they met for worship, they had the equivalent of what we call in this country a potluck. But the person who didn't have a pot in the city of Corinth was out of luck. He remained hungry. Some people brought roasted lamb and potatoes, others brought lentil soup, and each person ate what he had brought. No one shared his food with the others. So there was no fellowship there. And that's why Paul told them, if you come to church only to eat, you can eat and drink in your private homes. But we come to church not to eat and drink, but to fellowship And fellowship means sharing everything with one another. Forbes.com has rated 100 American cities and found the city of Rochester in New York to be the most friendly city in America and the best place to raise a family. So let's all run, should we all run to Rochester in New York? It's been acknowledged for being the most friendly city in America. Now wouldn't it be nice if our church is recognized as the most friendly church in Pasadena? Think of the impact we would make if we become recognized as the most friendly church in Pasadena. Just think about it, pray about it, and ask the Lord that this church be transformed into the friendliest church in this city. And to God be the glory.